Philippine solar power producer Citicor Renewable Energy Corporation hopes to finally go public next year. That's a year behind its original target. CREC is the parent company of Citicor Energy REIT, the country's first renewable energy real estate investment trust to list at the Philippine Stock Exchange. Now, last week, it secured a $100 million loan from Singapore-based Pentagreen Capital, which will be used to fund its six solar projects in Luzon. The company also aiming to expand its renewable energy portfolio to support the government's energy targets for 2030.
The idea is to expand our market reach because currently we are supplying to day peak customer because our solar plant are basically peaking plants during daytime. We intend to expand our market reach to be able to cater to night peak customer also.
Yeah.
And towards a more like a base load, like a pure renewable energy. And we can only achieve that once we have a portfolio of solar, wind, hydro, and to be further complemented by energy storage system.
The Land Transportation Office studying possible changes to the driver's license exam with the goal of creating a customized set of questions based on the applicant's intended driving plans. The proposal will be tackled during this week's LTO District's conference. The issue, of course, was prompted by several road rage incidents that went viral on social media.
At this stage, this is all in the study level pa lang. Wala pang finality to kasi ayaw rin naman natin na napakahaba ng exam. No? So all these are now being studied since we are reviewing the exam itself, no, including the processes sa pagkuha ng lisensya. Eh, we might as well take a look also if there's any enhancements that we need to do dun sa content ng ating exam. Ayaw lang natin maging, you know, you're trying to filter 1% of the population at tapos papihirapan mo yung 99% of the population. Parang hindi yata tama yung ganun, no?
LTO is also pushing for a special law that will clearly define and penalize road rage incidents. The current law limits LTO to imposing a penalty on road rage violators of under 4 years. Philippine House Speaker Martin Romualdez appealing to oil companies to help curb domestic fuel costs by cutting their profit margins. Romualdez requested this during a closed-door meeting on Monday with energy officials and oil industry executives. The oil companies, in turn, urged the government to suspend the excise tax on fuel. Fuel products are currently slapped with an excise tax of 10 pesos per liter for gasoline and 6 per liter for diesel. Both also levied a 12% value-added tax.
I've also gotten some feedback from some of our congressmen here. Baka we can exercise this backwardization that we can already perhaps even explore buying oil early or in advance, no? And not wait till December, so we can get better prices by securing our oil requirements and by making advance purchases or orders.
This as local pump prices go up again today for the 11th straight week. This brings total increase in petroleum prices since July to over 17 pesos per liter. For diesel, nearly 16 pesos for kerosene and around 12 pesos for gasoline. The Energy Department warns the price hikes could continue until the end of the year as Russia and Saudi Arabia slash their production throughout 2023. Several agricultural groups calling for the resignation of the Philippine finance chief and the country's top economist over their rice tariff policies. But Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno insists his agency is only supporting policies that are good for the greatest good. More from Andrea Taguines.
Recent floods have wiped out Iyahamandres rice field in the town of Camiling in Tarlac Province. She has yet to recover from the impact of the storms, but she's fearing the proposed tariff reduction on rice imports. While it's meant to lower the price of rice in the market, Iya says it will also further bring down the farm gate price of palay to the detriment of farmers. Iya joined other farmers from other provinces in Metro Manila on Monday to protest the policy.
Pa po anihan, 17 na po yung kuha po ng mga traders sa amin. Paano na lang kaya pagkasagsagan na po ng anihan? Baka bababa pa po sa 17. Paano pa po kami makakabangon sa presyo na yon?
Apart from its impact on farm gate prices, farmers fear removing import tariffs on rice will also take away from the Rice Competitiveness Enhancement Fund, or RCEF, a fund meant to help farmers remain competitive amid the entry of rice imports.
Kasi, di ba, yung kita doon sa taripa, yun ang ginagamit sa RCEF, na binibigay sa amin mga farmers, pati Farm Mechanization Program, mawawala na yan lahat.
From Quezon City to Manila, farmers groups marched to the offices of several government agencies and groups who are in favor of lowering or cutting the import tariffs on rice to voice their opposition. Their last stop here at the Department of Finance headquarters, where they also called for the removal from office of DOF Secretary Benjamin Jokno and NEDA Director General Arsenio Balisacan for proposing the policy in the first place. In a statement, Jokno said Malacañang is still discussing the proposal. But he stood his ground, saying it's the appropriate policy response that promotes the greatest good for the greatest number of Filipinos. He also assured local farmers the government will continue to pursue measures that would balance their interests while keeping rice affordable for consumers. In line with this, the National Food Authority, which is chaired by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., has agreed to raise the maximum buying rate for palay. Marcos announced that the NFA will now buy dry palay for 19 pesos to 23 pesos per kilo, while wet palay will be bought for 16 to 19 pesos per kilo.
Ang production cost naman ng mga farmer ngayon mas nasa 14-15. So meron na silang pagkikitaan. At bukod pa ron, nandiyan na yung price cap. So para maikalma natin itong nangyayari sa rice price.
Agricultural group SINAG welcomed this development, but it said Marcos should ensure that it will be properly implemented. The Department of Agriculture, for its part, said it would support the NFA proposal but at a level of 23 pesos a kilo. The agency added that farmers are satisfied with 23 pesos since they are now being paid 16 to 19 pesos per kilo. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine authorities discover 82 million pesos worth of suspected smuggled rice in warehouses in Las Piñas, Cavite, and Zamboanga. In an anti-smuggling operation conducted last week, authorities found the stored grains came from Vietnam, Thailand, and China. The warehouse owners, however, claim they're traders and not rice importers. The owner has 15 days to submit proof of payment of duties and taxes from their supplier or importer. The government has been ramping up efforts to fight smuggling and hoarding, which they also blame for the soaring prices of rice in the market. President Marcos has imposed a price ceiling on rice nationwide to help stabilize their prices. The National Bureau of Investigation recommending the filing of cases against several government officials, a cooperative head, and traders for alleged hoarding and profiteering in onions. Nico Bawa reports.
The NBI Anti-Organized and Transnational Crimes Division submitted to the Department of Justice the findings of its probe on the surge in onion prices. The Bureau recommended cases against three officials of the Department of Agriculture and the chairman of Bonena Multipurpose Cooperative, Israel Reguyal, and two of his traders. The charges include violation of the Anti-Graft and Corrupt Practices Act and the Philippine Competition Act, hoarding, profiteering, unfair or unconscionable sales act or practice, technical malversation, falsification of private documents, use of falsified documents, and inefficiency and incompetence as public officials were also recommended. Some stakeholders stood as witnesses. They requested the DA and the BPI to import onions last August 2022 since they knew that stocks were already low. But the DA did not import onions.
Question namin bakit hindi sila nagpasok ng time ng September. Ang sabi ni Glenn is dahil yun nga, yung grupo ni Israel ang nagsabing huwag na magpasok ng puting sibuyas. Sinabi naman ni Israel at that time, doon sa meeting na yun, kasi may mga pulang sibuyas pa kami.
To mitigate the waning supply, the DA procured onions from Reguyal of the Bonena Multipurpose Cooperative at 537 pesos per kilo last December, which was sold in Kadiwa stores at 170 pesos per kilo. But members of the cooperative explained to the NBI that they had nothing to do with the procurement and that their records were falsified.
Pagsamantalahan yung kooperatiba, yung masakit. Kasi nagamit yun, nakipag-deal sa ganito na hindi namin alam. Wala kaming kaalam-alam talaga.
Based on the DA's records, two onion suppliers competed with Reguyal for the procurement contract. But that was far from the truth.
May tinatawag na procurement mode, no? So ang minimum kasi, 3 bidders dapat. So ang 3 bidders actually, iisa lang yung gumawa ng 3 bids, no? And nag-falsify sila ng documents, malinaw na malinaw, na yung dalawang supposedly other bidders, hindi alam na sumama sila sa bid.
The investigation also questioned why the DA agreed to Reguyal's offer of 537 pesos per kilo of onions when the records of the Philippine Statistics Authority showed that the price of onions was at 305 pesos per kilo that time.
Sila po ay talagang lumalabas na mayroong pungsala sa pagkakataong ito. At hindi pa, ito'y simula pa lang, marami pa hong kasong ifa-file. At tuloy-tuloy po yung investigasyon ng NBI.
ABS-CBN News sought the side of Reguyal, but he has yet to give a statement. The DA has yet to comment on the NBI's findings. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla says they will still evaluate the recommendations of the NBI. Nico Bawa, ABS-CBN News.
Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, together with Bayan Muna Partylist Group, filed a petition before the Supreme Court seeking to declare the Maharlika Investment Fund unconstitutional. Robert Manyo reports.
Resolution. The Maharlika Investment Fund Act of 2023 is unconstitutional. This is the claim of Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, Bayan Muna Chairman Nery Colmenares, and former Bayan Muna Representatives Carlos Zarate and Ferdinand Gaite as they filed a petition for certiorari and prohibition before the Supreme Court on Monday. The petitioners contended that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s utilization of the authority to declare the Maharlika Bill as urgent in both the House of Representatives and the Senate was invalid because there was no public calamity or public emergency during that period.
During this time, na there's a worldwide, in fact, recession, no? Yung ibang malalaking bansa nga ay ingat na ingat sila, no? Pero ito, ang Pilipinas, tayo, gumawa tayo ng ganitong pondo, niligay sa isang korporasyon na napaka hindi sigurado yung accountability.
The petitioners also claimed that Congress violated the no amendment clause due to mistakes left in the measure even after it had passed Congress on third reading. Additionally, they asserted that the establishment of the Maharlika Investment Fund, categorized as government-owned and controlled corporation, did not fulfill the economic viability standards mandated by law.
Maglalaan tayo ng pondo sa isang korporasyon na hindi naman natin alam kung kikita. Sa gitna ng walang ayuda, mahal na presyo ng bilihin, maglalaan tayo ng hundreds of billions of peso sa isang korporasyon na hindi nga natin kilala kung sino mga direktor. Pag humingi ang senior citizen ng dagdag na pensyon, walang pondo. Humingi ang mga mangingisda ng Mindoro, dagdag na ayuda, walang pondo. Ito, ni hindi pa nga na-appoint yung mga direktor, may 75 billion na agad.
The petitioners also claim that the Maharlika Investment Fund law violates the independence of the Central Bank of the Philippines, which is mandated to contribute 100% of its dividends to the fund for the first 2 years.
Ang Maharlika ay hindi independent sa Malacanang at maaring gamitin ang pondo nito sa korupsyon o cronyism na kung saan papaboran ang mga negosyante na kaibigan ng Malacanang at masasangkot dito ang BSP.
Respondents named in the petition were Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin, Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno, the Senate, and the House of Representatives. The petitioners also requested the Supreme Court to prohibit the respondents from continuing to enforce the law, saying its ongoing enforcement will cause irreparable harm and injury to the general public. Robert Mano, ABS-CBN News.
Solicitor General Menardo Guevara, meanwhile, says the filing of a petition challenging the validity of the Maharlika Fund is not unexpected, adding he has been monitoring public discourse on the subject since day one, but he reserves any further comments until he sees a copy of the petition. It's a story that's drawn comparisons to the Oscar-winning Slumdog Millionaire. An Indian teen who once lived with her family in a waterfront slum in Mumbai is now a supermodel and an internet sensation. It's all thanks to a chance encounter with American actor and choreographer Robert Hoffman, who posted videos of his time with Malisha Karwa and her family. Hoffman helped launch a GoFundMe campaign, which would turn Malisha into a social media influencer. But her charm eventually landed her modeling gigs, and she's become the face of a luxury Indian cosmetics brand. Now upgraded to a one-room apartment, Malisha is still focused on her schooling, but with an eye towards the future of her career.